Hi everyone. This is the lecture for week one of Theories of Organizational Behavior and Development. A quick overview of what we're going to do. Just cover a few big ideas about the class. We're going to talk just for a second about the sort of utility of theories and the structure of theories. Then move on to some of the benefits and drawback of organization, benefits and drawbacks of organizations. And then we'll finish up with just a few other terms to know, and then just my thoughts on how to sort of get the most out of this class. So let me move myself real quick. So what's the big idea for this class? The big idea really is that most, if not all, of social work practice occurs in the context of an organization. That means that organizations have a pretty substantial influence on the quality of care or the quality of services that social workers can deliver. So let me take that first point here for a second, and that's that most, if not all, of social work practice occurs in the context of an organization. So consider that most social workers are employed by an organization to do something. Right, and locally there are a number of organizations that that employ social workers. Some of them are governments, governmental organizations. Some of them are nonprofits. Some of them might even be for-profit. Even social workers who work in private practice, they also, I mean, they might be an organization of one. But they're still going to interact with organizations. Their billing and reimbursement is going to come from an organization. They might be referred to, or they might be referred clients by some kind of organization. And consider that all of us interact with an organization known as the National Association of Social Workers, which manages our sort of code of ethics. So big idea number one is that most, if not all, of social work practice occurs in the context of an organization. And so big idea number two is that consequently, organizations have an influence on the quality of care that social workers can deliver. And that influence might be good or it might be bad. And I've provided just like really sort of a really simple example here. In the last two bullet points on the slide, consider that an agency is required to treat both mental health and substance use problems simultaneously. That's probably an example of how an organization can have a positive effect on the quality or the nature of care that a social worker is delivering. Example number two, and this is sort of how an organization might have a bad or a negative influence on the quality of care that a social worker delivers. Consider that a substance use treatment agency can't treat someone whose primary diagnosis is a mental health diagnosis, right? So it would keep that person from care. So why is, whoops, sorry about that. Why is this class part of the MSW program? And the answer to that is that it's important that we understand the influences that organizations have on social work practice. And if we have an understanding of the influence that the organizations have, we can contribute to the growth or change of those organizations. And ideally, the end result of contributing to the growth or change of an organization would be that social workers can then deliver more effective, higher quality, just all around better kinds of interventions. So if you notice, the book for this class has to do with organizational change, and really the second, I don't know if you want to call it, it's not, definitely not the second half, but sort of the last couple of classes of the semester are dealing with organizational change. So to study organizations, we're gonna talk about a number of different organizational theories, and that sort of comes in weeks like 3 through about 7. Theories are nothing more than conceptual systems that identify, organize, describe, and explain some parts of the world. We've taken classes before on theories of human behavior. Now we're taking a class on theories of organizational behavior. And the same principles or the same theories have the same utility. They help us organize our thinking about how organizations behave, just as in a human behavior class, theories help us organize our thinking about human behavior. Now, good theories and a good understanding of theory can also help predict behavior. And we'll use some of the theories that we talk about in an attempt to maybe make some predictions about how organizations might behave. Keep an eye out when we study theories. Keep an eye out for sort of a list of principles or the sort of main ideas of those theories. I think that's probably the easiest way to learn them. The lectures that you'll get from me typically I attempt to provide an outline or an overview of that particular theory. So my lectures tend to sort of go along with the reading and help to summarize and interpret what you're getting in the reading. So believe it or not, organizations are not necessarily bad or something to be fought against. In at least in the social work profession, organizations do a number of things. First of all, they have reputations. You know, they have clout, right? They have capital that they can use to attempt to do good in a particular community. Social work organizations often have licenses to do something specific. So they might be licensed to provide child welfare. They might be licensed to provide substance use treatment or mental health treatment or something like that. And the fact that the organization can hold the license means that you can come in, a social worker as an employee can come in and do that work. Organizations can interact with regulators, the people who provide the license and sort of regulate the operating environment. Right. Organizations also have monetary capital, so they provide buildings, space, desks, phone systems, you know, file folders, you know, server storage, IT systems, computers, right? All of that good stuff. So they take care of all that infrastructure stuff, so that employees can focus on their jobs. If sort of going back to this idea about a social worker in private practice, that social worker in a private practice has to take care of all those things, right? He or she has to take care of, you know, computers and phones and paying the rent, paying utilities and things like that. And that's not stuff that a social worker can be reimbursed for, right? A social worker in a private practice can only be reimbursed for providing services. Now, am I trying to sort of downplay the importance and sort of the benefits of private practice? Absolutely not. But what I'm trying to do here is sort of highlight the benefits of an organization. And these last two are actually quite important. Organizations can help us grow our careers. They provide resources and they sanction time away from providing clinical services for professional development. And sometimes they even pay for that professional development. So organizations have this ability to sort of help people advance their careers. All of this is to sort of say that organizations take advantage of this thing called an economy of scale. We're going to talk more about this in a little bit more detail in next week. But to sort of give you the gist of what an economy of scale is right now, an organization can take care of certain functions much more efficiently and inexpensively than an individual can. And that helps the organization do good. That helps the organization advance its mission or advance its goals and vision of the world. So organizations have a number of benefits. They also, frankly, have some drawbacks, right? Organizations can experience financial problems. Those bureaucracies, especially if it's a big organization, can be inefficient and inflexible. They can be rigid. A good example of this is just sort of a generic example, but universities are and colleges are sort of examples of sort of huge and rigid bureaucracies. And if you've ever needed to get a form signed for a university, you have to take that form to, three and four and five different people to get it signed. And if all of those signatures aren't affixed or attached to that particular statement or to that particular form, the person whose job it is to process that form won't accept it, right? Lastly, the sort of last drawback of organizations that I could think of just sort of off the top of my head was that those mission and vision statements can become stale or outdated. They need to be updated from time to time. So, like I said, for as many benefits as organizations have, they do have some drawbacks as well. I think the thing to know at this point is that organizations are and have been a part of social work practice for a very, very long time. And going back to sort of the point I made on this slide, if we understand how organizations function and change, we can help them change in service of providing better, more effective, more efficient, however you want to think of it, but better interventions, right? We can sort of use them to enhance the good work that we're doing as a profession. So a few other things to know. Social work organizations are regulated typically by government agencies. That government agency could be state or it could be federal. Here in New York State, substance use treatment is regulated by OASAS, which is the Office of Alcoholism and Substance Abuse Services. Another example, OCFS, the Office of Child and Family Services, would regulate some portion of child welfare. Obviously, these are only two sort of very specific fields, and there are, dozens more sort of regulating agencies. And I'm sure you're aware of some of them as well. And then, social work is not the only profession that this is true for, but regulations are influenced by politics, and so conservatives and liberals, for example, have very different opinions on how schools should be run. They might also have very different opinions on how substance use treatments services should be run. So these regulations that influence the organizations that we work in are fluid. They're changing, and they change based on who happens to wield political power at that particular point in time. A few other terms to know. One of them is this idea of a system of care, and a system of care is simply the variety of agencies that respond to a specific problem. Some agencies encompass or live at sort of different points at that system of care, but sometimes different exam excuse me, different agencies are responsible for functioning at a particular system of care. So here's a really basic example. There's outpatient substance use disorder treatment, and there's inpatient substance use disorder treatment. Inpatient is considered a higher level of care, or a step up that particular system of care. Now, typically, we want to keep people at the lowest level of care, the least restrictive level of care. And in general, that's less expensive, and generally people have a much better prognosis if they stay at a low level of care. Last thing to know about sort of systems of care is that they can certainly intersect. And example that I could think of, again, just sort of off the top of my head, was that child welfare workers are occasionally responsible for hospitalizing children with really severe problems. So, and so in that example, in that really generic example, we see child welfare, the system of child welfare intersecting with, say, the mental health care system. Now, social workers work in, dozens of different kind of systems of care. I've listed just a few of them here, and certainly there are others, but education, health and mental health, disability, substance use treatment, criminal justice, immigration, public health, so on and so forth. And like I said, there's probably other examples that you can think of. But give some thought to how different systems might intersect. For example, there are lots of times or lots of points where the substance use treatment system and the criminal justice treatment system intersect. For example, if a person got an impaired driving offense or something like that, they might then be part of both of those systems. So this is the last slide here. The real benefit of this class, I think, is it gives you a chance to think about an organization that you might want to work for someday. And it gives you a chance to sort of study that organization and study the regulatory environment that it lives in and think about the sort of system of care in which that agency functions. So the last paper in this class, the organizational analysis paper, you might choose to write that paper on the organization and on an organization that you want to work for at some point. That would give you certain advantages in an interview and sort of preparing for that interview. It's actually part of the reason I ask about your ideal social work job in the discussion for this week. That's to help get you thinking about an agency that you might want to work in when you leave the MSW program and transition into a professional role. So, this isn't a clinical course. This class, I really think of it as forming some of the background information that social workers rely on day to day. So it's really useful to get to know a system of care and organizations that lie at higher levels of care and lower levels of care. It's good to get to know those systems so that you have a working knowledge of sort of the different agencies that clients may need to come in and interact with. It's also a good example, or excuse me, the other utility of this class is to be able to think in terms of systems. And so what happens if a client has to move up a level of care or has an issue that requires interacting with a different system? So thanks for watching. As always, if you have any questions, feel free to get in touch with me or post on the discussion board.